tuned in to the Cosmic Combos Podcast, your number one source for accurate, relevant, and thought-provoking astrological conversations in the podcast nation, the place where stars and minds align.
Peace, you are now tuned into the Cosmic Combos Podcast. I'm your humbled host, Harut, and we got the man of the hour, Master Astrologer, Brother Ra. How you doing?
Oh, well, brother. Well, how about yourself, King?
Pretty good, man. So, you know, it seems like that the first episode did pretty good, man. A lot of good feedback, man. How you feel about it?
I loved it, man. You know, I definitely thought it was an excellent podcast that we put out there to the world to get the party started, and we're going to get nothing but better from here, King. So I'm definitely pleased.
Indeed. So just want to start off this this episode is brought to you by Pushing Forward Media Group and Kala Purusha Astrology. Brother Rod, where could we get to you at Kala Purusha?
You can find me on several avenues. I actually have a YouTube channel called Kala Purusha Astrology. You type it in, it pops right on up. You can also find me on Facebook under Shechem Ra, and you can also even find me on IG at Shechem Ra. So I'm not hard to find, King.
Indeed. You can find Push It Forward Media at pushitforward.com. That's PUSHITFWD.com. On Instagram at Push It Forward. And there you'll find Veg Kingdom, and you'll find, you know, the Cosmic Convos podcast and everything we're working with. And make sure that you follow us at Cosmic Convo on Instagram. You know, like the post, comment on the post, send us messages. Let us know what you want to hear. All right. So before we get started, Brother Rod, you got any announcements, anything that you want to let the people know?
Yes, sir. There will be another video coming out on some interesting information. A very famous individual that the chart of this individual has been done probably more than most entertainers. I'll give you a hint. It's an entertainer. But it'll be out this week, hopefully to release simultaneous with the podcast. So be looking for it on Kala Purusha Astrology.
Good deal. Definitely looking forward to that. That U.S. and Iran video, man, is doing pretty good numbers right now. A lot of people seem to be very interested in that. So we're definitely looking forward to that.
No doubt. Yeah, it's going to be definitely something to take note of.
Indeed. So, you know, just kind of looking at some of the feedback and talking to people who, you know, who listened to our first episode, seems a lot of people are interested in learning more, you know, kind of the differences between sidereal and tropical astrology. There's a lot of people out there who, you know, they traffic, you know, in the world of astrology, but it's surprising to hear that a lot of people don't know about sidereal. And we touched on that a little bit on the first episode, but, you know, Brother Rod, you got any more information you want to give, you know, going maybe a little more nuance into the differences between the two systems?
You know, Harut, I'm glad we're talking about this because, you know, you're right. You know, sidereal is gaining traction here in the West, and it is not something that is typically known that there, you know, there's a difference between or there is another system rather that is that uses a fundamental different measurement tool to gain insight into the planetary placements. In the last show, we talked about the history of you know, where those mistakes and changes and shifts came into play. And today, we're going to more or less delve into what those differences are, and not only as far as the measurements, but the different ways this knowledge is used. And primarily, we're talking about in the East. You know, I don't want to make it a difference between East and West, because the West definitely brings some things to the table, and the East brings some things to the table. And we can merge the two. We get the best of both worlds. But there are some fundamental primary differences in the way the knowledge is used in the East. And, you know, the one thing that the West or tropical is phenomenal for is really talking about the sun sign. You know, that's the jump off, if you will, for conversations around the world with regards to people and meeting other individuals and trying to kind of get an insight of, you know, the character and the inner milieu of individuals' mindsets, right? You know, a lot of people talk about, you know, I mean, there's songs about it, man, you know, computer love, I don't need astrology, I have my computer, da-da-da-da-da, you know, they got a kind of newspaper articles and, you know, stuff where you look up your sign and see what's going on, you know. That's pretty much, you know, the mainstay of what people think is that you are your sun sign. And it's not to say that you're not, you absolutely are, but it's a different approach in the East. Much different in that we look at the moon as your primary character, the primary set of characteristics that we would really say that's your sign. And the funny thing is that you have many signs, right? You have planets, you have Mars in placements, you have Jupiter in placements, you have all nine planetary influences in placements, right? The one thing I also want to mention before we get deeper into the show, one of the fundamental differences is that we use the outer planets differently, right? The outer planets are used in a very hairline, tight, when I say tight, we're talking about the difference as far as degrees are concerned. The outer planets are used in a very different way because the outer planets have less of an impact on our everyday life, right? But we'll talk on that later, but I just kind of want to make mention of that before we get started, because you have different planetary placements. We have different signs. Some of us have several placements in several areas, so it's not that you're just a sun sign or a moon sign. But if I had to boil it down to, let's say, a planet and say that's who I would identify you as, it would be the moon. And reason being is because, you know, no one has ever seen, right, the sun in Leo, right? No one's ever seen the sun in Virgo because the sun is shining, right, during the day, and it's invisible to us at night, right? So you can't see it in a sign per se, right? But you can see the moon in a sign. I mean, Atef, have you ever looked out in the night sky and seen planets in certain placements and said, oh, you know what? I can see that Jupiter's in Scorpio or that Saturn's in Sag. Have you ever done that before, King?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Especially Venus.
Oh, right. Venus is the bright morning star, right? You can't miss it, right? It's the third largest heavenly, it's the third brightest, excuse me, heavenly body in the night sky, right? So, or in the sky, rather. Sun being the first, moon second, and Venus third. So, you know, when we look out and we actually look into the heavens, we look to see where they're placed. And you can't see the sun in a sign, right? The only way we can see the sun in a sign, if we were to get technical, is to look out due east early morning before the sun rises, and you will see the constellation rising prior to the sun rising. So we could juxtapose that. Well, we know if that's Virgo rising and the sun is coming up behind it, right, then we know that it's more than likely going to be in the next sign after 2 hours in Libra.
Indeed.
Right.
Indeed, indeed.
So that's kind of how we would say that we could necessarily see what it is, but we can't see it in that sign. But we can see the moon in all of the constellations at any given night, right?
So before you get too down that path, you brought up something interesting a little second ago about dealing with the outer planets and the inner planets. Now, when you're talking about the outer planets, you're talking about Uranus, Neptune, Pluto, and such, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The inner planets are what we consider in astrology, sun, moon, Mercury, Mars, Venus, Jupiter, Saturn, and then we would acquiesce the nodes because they're given planetary status as well, Rahu and Ketu, right? Or the northern node and southern node. Talking about the outer planets, we are mentioning Uranus, we are mentioning Neptune, and we're talking about Pluto. And, you know, those cycles of those planets are far too long. And I'll even give Uranus a little love, right? We can use Uranus in a very lightweight degree, right? In the sense that it takes 84 years for that planet to make one complete circuit. Well, if we understand psychology or mental sciences, you know, you can't do anything right. Just really usually very challenging to do something right the first time. Right. Usually man learns over time and through experiences. And so that planet taking 84 years, man's allotted lifetime on this earth is 120 years. So within that 120 years, we only get one go around with Uranus. Right. Well, Neptune is 164 years. Right. No one on this planet is going to get a Neptune return. Right. Unless you're in the Himalayas somewhere, right? Eating goji berries, right, and brown rice, right, or you know, or if you're a Chinese Taoist master, right, you might get a planetary return with Neptune, but Pluto takes 248 years to make a return. There's just no way, right, that we can extract knowledge from those planetary cycles. Now, we do use them in mundane astrology because in mundane astrology, those countries and businesses and things that extend over large periods of time, right, can have larger options to reap the return of those larger cycles, right? So, well, go ahead, brother.
Yeah, well, you know, there's you got those points, but even looking at it, just at a, you know, just an everyday level, we got 7 days of the week. Mm-hmm. You know, each one of those days is, you know, ruled by a planet. Seven colors in the spectrum.
That's right. You seven know. Chakras, right, and so forth.
Well, 14, if you but
we know, brother. We get deep with it. We got so. But nonetheless, those cycles are too grand, right, for man to really reap the benefits of those, that knowledge that you get from making that complete circle or circuit or completing that cycle. And so we use them in larger scales. Now, here's the thing. Like I said, we can use those planets when they're very, very close to a very prominent planet, i.e. the ascendant degree or the cusp of the ascendant, the moon, or the sun, right? And sometimes other planets as well, given that it's a very tight degree. When I say tight degree, I'm talking about 1 degree, less than 1 degree, maybe 2 degrees. I even might even give 3, depending on the planet or the placement. But for the most part, we don't use them in, it's not in vogue to use them in natal astrology, right? So I hope that, you know, kind of elucidates that for you, brother, if that makes sense. We just, the cycles are too vast for us to reap the benefits and rewards.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So, you know, back to the differences and starting off, you know, again, sidereal is a fundamental difference in the way we approach this. And so when we say sidereal, again, we look up in the sky and we actually say, hey, you know what? Venus is in Gemini, right? We can see Venus in the constellation, right? Or aligned with the constellation of Gemini. So we don't have to go to a system or a computer or ephemeris or a book. I mean, we can and we should to get, you know, the minute points of where it's placed. But without it, we can still see the portents of the sky, meaning we can still see the placement and its influences on Earth. Right. And that's how most ancient cultures did it. I mean, we're talking about the Chinese. We're talking about India, people from India. We're talking about the Babylonians, the ancient Egyptians. Most cultures, even Mayans, right, they use, right, what's in the heavens to actually record and make note of what's going to happen on Earth. So that's really the fundamental basis of Jyotish or Eastern astrology, is that they use the actual night sky to gain insight into what's going on Earth. Now, that's about 20. The difference between the two, and I mentioned that in the last podcast, is that the difference is about 23 to 24 degrees, right? Between, that's almost a whole sign away. So when we actually talk about sidereal or talk about Jyotish, you know, you can say it almost one and the same. Now, there's a few people out there that kind of have made some different adjustments to use tropical with other placements, but that's a whole other story I don't want to get into for today's session. But the basic difference is that it is a sidereal system, meaning it is used to, the stars are used to gain insight into what's going on relative to the night sky. Tropical uses the seasons, meaning that they fixed things for all time. March 21st, 10,000 years from now, will be Aries, right? Well, 10,000 years from now, no. The placements in the heavens won't even look like that at all, right? So it'd be completely different. So they fixed it. They locked it, right? They said that, you know what? Forget about all this stuff with Ayyanamshas. And what an Ayyanamsha is the difference of that particular 24 degrees to the other system. In fact, one's called Nirayana and one's called Sayana. Sayana is tropical and Nirayana is sidereal. And so when we look at the 24 degree difference, right, we're going to get a different reading, right, from what the Sayana or the tropical version would give us. It's going to be different. So, for example, my Venus is in Cancer, right? And in the Western system, my Venus would be in Leo, right? So that right there, I can tell you, brother, right? It's not correct because I know the type of women that I definitely have attracted. They're not Leo-like, right? You know, just to give an example, right? Just to give a quick example, I know your moon is placed in Leo, if I'm correct, right, brother?
Yeah.
So your moon's going to knock over to Virgo, right? I don't get that Virgoan juxtaposition from you, right? I get that Leonine, confident, right? I'm a man's man. I know what I need to do, right? I'm the king type of energy, right? Very confident, very assured, right? Very authoritative. Virgo is very different, right? So you can see, you can play with the planets. And sometimes I would just advise people out there just to test it, see what it says for yourself. And, you know, you'll find in the West that we get locked into a theory or a belief, and the astrology becomes a belief system instead of a knowledge system. And that's where it gets dangerous, right?
Yeah. And, you know, kind of with that, I mean, because you're talking about moons, and most people, if they know that they're talking about the sun sign, they're usually looking to the sun for the personality. And, you know, you were talking about, you know, how the outer planets, that span, that time that they're in a sign is kind of, is kind of a wide window range to be able to, you know, to be able to really, you know, utilize it in a practical manner that way. Would you say, even though the sun is not, you know, 120 years or so, but would you say even 30 days is too large of a window to kind of distinguish between the amount of people born within that cycle to say that this is the source of someone's personality?
Excellent, excellent question. And, you know, that's the next real thing that I was going to mention with regards to the difference. I mentioned it earlier briefly with regards to the moon and the sun. The moon moves 13 degrees, 20 minutes every day. Right. The sun stays in one sign for 30 days. So absolutely, that refinement through the moon is going to give you more precise, more specific, more down home understanding of what that person's personality traits are. The sun, how many people are born on August 21st? Quite a few. Wilt Chamberlain's born on August 21st. I mean, there's quite a few, right? Well, me and Wilt aren't the same, right?
Yeah.
Right? We're very different, right? Well, his moon is going to be placed differently, right? So that moon is the filter of consciousness, right? It's the reflective lens that we use in order to kind of navigate reality, if you will. And so in India, right, when they say, hey, my friend, what's your sign? They mean your moon sign. Right. You know, it's called a Janana Rashi. Rashi is a constellation, right? Rashi means heap, right? Heap of stars. So when they say, hey, what's your sign? They mean your moon sign, right? And your moon sign, right, or your Janma Rashi, right, is more specific to your birth, right? It's based on the day you're born more, right, than the actual, let me say the day, it's not like your sun sign where it can be shared for 30 days, right? It's going to be very quick. The moon moves one sign every 2 days, right? 2.25 days, right? 2.25 days. So every 2.25 days, the moon is going to be in a new sign. So if we share moon signs, we're going to have a lot more affinity than the sun sign. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Right. And even in fact, in India, the way they name their children many times is based on that moon sign. The moon, given being in a specific position, right, yields a certain sound, right? And that's based on the next thing that we're going to delve into is the nakshatra, right? And nakshatra is how the moon moves through the heavens, right? It's 27 different lunar mansions in the heavens. Some say 28, right? Even the Arabic system of astrology uses lunar mansions, right? So the lunar mansions are really hold power in the East, right? Because they really define your mental composition, right? Your mental apparatus, how you literally, like I said, filter reality. Like, you know, this is kind of how I give people an understanding. Some of my students, I tell them like this, you know, you have a car, right? And you have a car, that car is a, let's say you're driving a Ferrari, right? Well, inside of the Ferrari, you have an interface, right, between you, right, and the car, which is like, you know, your radio, your steering wheel, right, your air conditioning, right, all the bells and whistles that kind of go into interfacing between you and the automobile, that's your moon, right? The automobile is your body, right? The moon is the operating system, the OS. Right. And then the sun is the driver. Right. So if the interface between the sun and the body is a little off, you're going to have mental aberrations, mental imbalances. If that makes sense to you, brother, is that a way that kind of drives it home?
Yeah, that's an excellent example.
Right. So, you know, indeed, the moon being an interface between, you know, the moon is not who you are, it's the interface of who you are, right? It's the system that allows you, it's the role, it's the glasses we put on, right, in order to navigate reality. So if I wear rose colored glasses, right, I'm gonna see nothing but rose, pink, right? If I wear yellow glasses, I'm gonna see yellow, right?
Yeah.
And so forth, right? So that's how we understand the moon. It's literally the way that the light comes in, we shift it, and then we put it into our spirit to kind of give it its special quality or its experience, if you will. Or how we kind of extract reality, right? Things from reality. So that's the moon, right? That's the power of the moon. It's that powerful. If the moon is off, then a lot of, no matter how great the chart is placed, the person is going to have challenges in life, right? The sun could be quite in a very peculiar situation, but the moon being strong is going to interface. It's going to uplift that person's spiritual apparatus so where they can function in a much more dynamic and much more healthy way, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. It does.
Okay. So
it does.
Go ahead, brother. You have any questions so far?
Well, I mean, you know, I guess just kind of, you know, going off of what you just said, you know, with sun and moon, you know, oftentimes like the moon is kind of metaphorically, you know, referred to as like the mother, and the sun is like the father, right?
True. True. Yeah. And who do you meet first? So,
you meet mama.
That's right, brother.
Like, it almost takes a while before, I mean, like, of course, father has an influence. And of course, you know, everybody's family dynamics are a little different. But, you know, just in a kind of a all things being equal type of case, a lot of times it takes you got to get a little older before you can learn something from your father. Like the things that the dad has to teach you, you got to grow up a little bit more to kind of take that on. Like if you're, you know, boy, you want to go and you want to go fishing. You can't do fishing as an infant. You know, it has to be some development that happens before you can learn the things that traditionally that, you know, a father would have to teach you. Would you?
Oh, brother, you said it better than I could say it at this point. You've said it exactly the way it's envisioned in the true form of astrology. You know, there's the thing, right? Even before you're an infant, you're a fetus, right? You're an embryo.
Yeah.
Whatever the mother eats, right, you will experience. Whatever the mother feels, you will experience. In fact, in Chinese medicine, there is a whole science to reproduction, right? Where the mother has to eat certain foods. She does certain things. She stays away from certain areas as far as feng shui. There's a whole apparatus that they really surround the mother with, because that fetus is really imbibing everything that's going on for that 9 to 10 month period. So literally, your flesh is her flesh, right? Your body is her body, right? And your mind, guess what? It's close to her mind.
Yeah.
So before you even hit the air, before you even come out and the water breaks, right? You are literally already, you have already met your mother, right? And, you know, even to segue that, the way we look at it as well is, you know, the ascendant, right, is your physical body, right? But what do we master first, right? You don't master your mind first, you master your body. So you learn to walk, talk, use the bathroom, right? You learn to control certain apparatuses, right? Balance, the whole bit. That takes a while, right? Well, once that's happened and the body is somewhat, you know, acclimated to the world, then the mind comes in, right? And how long does it take for us to master the mind? Well, in African terms, it takes 28 years.
Yeah.
Right? And if we really think about it, because the moon is akin to the brain, right? When we want to see if someone has brain problems, literally physiologically, we can look to the moon. If we see the moon is, you know, altered, that brain may have some alteration. Literally, the neurological status of that brain may be defunct, or right, it may have some issues. So the moon is the mind, and it takes 28 years for the moon to return to the exact same position of your birth, right? In neurological science, it takes 25 years, right, for the frontal lobes of the brain to come on. Right. So literally when you're 17, 16, right, 18, 19, 20, 21, right, your brain, that mind is still formulating. Well, guess what? After 28, you have to still learn to use those frontal lobes and master that.
Right? Yeah.
So as you begin to get older, you gain more self-mastery. It's called self-control. Right. And so when you gain that control, then the sun turns on. Right. And the sun is like that conscience, right? It's that silent voice, right? That tells you, you know what, you know you need to be doing this. And it gets louder as we get older, and louder as we get older, and your conscience becomes more prevalent. The sun becomes more prevalent, right? So then your sun sign takes over the role, and then you have an interlace of mind, body, and soul, right? So that's another way of looking at that. And the importance, right, of understanding the roles each one of those play. And from that, right, the moon, as we stated, moves 13 degrees, 20 minutes every day. Well, 13 degrees, 20 minutes is the equivalent of what we call a nakshatra. Right.
Yes.
And go ahead, brother.
No. I'm with you.
I got you. So nakshatras, right, are the lunar mansions. Right. And so, guess what? We talked about how you have the same sun sign as someone else. Well, within one sign, you have different variances. So not all Leos are the same, right? Not all Leonine energies are going to reveal the same output of energy, right? Not all Cancers are the same. Not all Geminis are the same. Every single sign has a portion of it that affords it a different energy output than the other portions. And that portion is 13 degrees, 20 minutes. and that is further subdivided into 3 degrees, 20 minutes. So now we can even take that, right, and narrow it down even more. And let's say you are born, we'll use the sun, for example, because it's a fundamental, it's a planet that we can track on a regular basis. That's the benefit of the sun. It's very regular, right? It doesn't go backwards. It stays on course, right? It stays the course. It doesn't, the speed doesn't change, right? And it's 1 degree per day, right? So when we look at the sun, let's say someone is born August 19th, right? That means their sun is more than likely going to be right around 1 degree, depending on the time they're born, maybe 2 degrees Leo. But that portion of Leo is called Magha, right? Well, that portion of Magha, right, which is ruled by another planet, it's ruled by a subplanet called, right, a sublord. And that sublord is Ketu, right? Or the southern node for many of us that may be Western astrologers.
So could you tell them what was southern node of what?
The moon, right? So again, there's back to the moon again, right? Right? Yep. Back to the moon again. The moon is that important. Well, that portion, right, of Leo is further affiliated, sub-affiliated with the sign of Aries. So now we can say that this person has these tertiary sets of characteristics, right? So we know Leo is there. Excuse me, brother. We know Leo is there as the primary influence, right? Then we have Ketu, right, as a secondary influence. And then we have Mars as a tertiary influence. So we have three influences that's going to literally shift the energy with that person born in that specific degree, right, versus the other degrees of that sign. So that's how important nakshatras are, right? That's how refining they are. They can get to the hair aspect of that person's makeup.
Indeed, indeed, indeed.
Now, the thing about nakshatras is that, the nakshatras are how we, so let's say if you're born in, let's say the moon is in Ardra, right? Ardra is ruled by, right, the portion of Gemini. Let me first clarify. Let's say you're born, your moon is in Gemini, right? And let's say it's 7 degrees Gemini. Right. So we can take that moon in Gemini and refine it to a nakshatra called Ardra. Ardra is ruled by the northern node of the moon called Rahu. Right. So Rahu, right, now has so much say over the moon that there is a system, right, one system that we use in Jyotish called dashas. Right. And there's different types of dashas, right? You have Ashtari dasha, Vimshatari dasha, you have Chara dasha. You've got a number of different dashas that you can use. And so with that being said, you know, there's different ways to even measure, right, that particular placement of that planet. Well, the moon, right, being in Ardra, being ruled by Rahu, right, it creates the jump off point for that person's life, because the moon is that important again. And again, you'll see the moon coming up over and over and over again. And I almost forgot to mention that the moon is an ascendant unto itself, right? We have what's called a Chandra Lagna. Lagna means ascendant. So we have not only your ascendant, but we have a Chandra Lagna or a moon ascendant, right? So when the moon is in that particular placement, then what we can do is say, well, you know what? That person's life, the chapters of their life are going to start from a Rahu disposition. And dashas are the life chapters, right? You have a book of life, right? Everyone has a book of life, right? So your book of life has different chapters, right? Different chapters, right, run differently. So sometimes you see some people and they're artists and painters, right? And they're all into art and painting. And next thing you know, they're into business, right? They've shifted. Something has shifted in their life, right? Well, that chapter has changed, right? Some people are married for 30 years and then the 31st year, they're done, right? New chapter, right? So you know, it depends on these chapters, and they're called dashas, right? Now, the dasha that's involved primarily in Jyotish and in India is called Vimshottari dasha. And it has about, it's connected to man's allotted life cycle of 120 years. And it works very well because of that. And with that, because the moon, as we mentioned, would be in Ardra in Gemini, that's going to start that life chapter off in the northern node. Right. So that person's jump off in life may be a little unorthodox. Right. It may be not picturesque. Right. Of what the way we would envision someone's life to start. So with that, those dashas, as they change, right, they change chapters, they change who you are, they unfold the potentials in your chart, they unfold the potentials in your spirit. Destiny comes in these vectors, if that makes sense to you, King.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Now, you know, I like to use examples, you know, because we could talk all day and it kind of makes sense to kind of give some real time examples of how that looks. Right. And so, you know, one of the famous characters that we could talk about is a gentleman that is very prominent in the world of basketball and sports, Mr. LeBron James. And LeBron, right, as we speak, right, is actually in a Venus dasha. Venus dashas run about 20 years, right? So he's been in it for quite some time. He's been in it since about 2001. But the fundamental thing about dashas is they kind of tell you what's going on in that person's life at that time, right? So if it's Jupiter dasha, the person might be very religiously oriented, right? They might have a very strong belief system. They might be close to God. They might attend temples or churches and things of that nature. That might be a very prominent thing in their life during that period. Again, I said might because it depends on how that planet is placed as well, houses, signs, nakshatras, aspects, and so forth. But you can pretty much guesstimate that that particular chapter of life is going to hold a lot of the portents or the signs that Jupiter embodies. Well, he's in a Venus dasha. So Venus, one of the things that Venus means, many things, but one of the things that Venus means in a general sense of the word is wife, especially in a man's chart, right? And so it means wife. It literally means who he's going to betroth, who he is going to connect to. And when that period hits, we can almost, and I've seen it over and over and over and over and over, Harut, where that Venus period hits, provided Venus is not truly damaged. And even if it is damaged, many times that person will be married during that dasha period. Now, of course, it depends on the age as well, because if you're starting off in a dasha period and you have very little dasha of Venus left and you're 6 years old, you're obviously not going to be married, right? But if you're an adult, right, of consensual age, right, that is something that is going to be heavy on your mind. And it's going to manifest in real time. And as far as the physical aspects of reality, it's going to manifest. Well, he is in a Venus dasha period, and he did get married during a Venus dasha period. Not to say that people don't get married during another dasha period. They absolutely do. It's a deep science to understanding how these planetary energies work. But we can always see the general consensus and get a good understanding of what's going on. Well, the thing is he married, right, in a Venus Jupiter dasha, right? Well, again, these dashas, right, as planetary periods, have assistants, if you will. We'll call them sub periods, but they're kind of like assistants to kind of help the main guy get the job done, if you will. So Jupiter, right, being the sub period or the sub dasha of Venus, right, Jupiter rules his seventh house. Seventh house lord, meaning it rules the house of marriage, and it's placed in the seventh house. So, bar none, right, when Venus says, hey, marriage time, hey, I'm going to go ahead and use the lord of your seventh house to get this done, you're going to get married at this time, right? And you can see it, bar none. You'll see it repetitiously over and over and over again. There's other ways to understand the dasha periods because they rule certain houses. And when they rule certain houses, they also yield the fruits of those houses as well. We won't get too much into that today. But nonetheless, right, just to give an understanding that Venus is the overall period and Jupiter is the administrator of that period. And Jupiter being the ruler of the seventh gives him a wife. Now, the prominent thing about it is that Jupiter is placed very well. Right. And another difference in, I want to say difference, but distinction of Eastern astrology, or specifically Jyotish, right, is that they use what are called yogas. Now, I know yoga is a word that's used in vogue very much so in the West now, because the West meets East, so to speak, and has been for probably since the 60s and 50s. But yoga is a word that means yoke, right? We're not talking about sitting down and meditating and being conscious of being conscious. We're not talking about stretching or controlling your prana or things like that. That's not when we say yoga. That's not what we mean. We mean literally linking or unifying or connecting. That's what the word yoga means. It means to yoke, to bring together. Right. So those planetary placements, as they're brought out in the chart, right, they give different yogas, different karmic outputs with regards to those placements. And LeBron has what's called a Hamsa yoga. Now, if LeBron, you listening, hit me up, man. We definitely talk, right? We can build. Jupiter, right, rules the seventh house. It's in its own sign, right? So since it's in its own sign in the seventh house, it gives prominence, meaning that it gives a very good wife. It's called a Hamsa yoga. It's called a Pancha Mahapurusha yoga. Pancha means five, Maha means great, and Purusha is the self, or when you say like God as well. Some people say God, right? But Pancha is five. So there's five primary Pancha. There's five primary Mahapurusha yogas. You have Hamsa, which is Jupiter in its own sign in 1, 4, 7, or 10. Sometimes they say 5 and 9 as well, fifth and ninth house as well. You have a Bhadra yoga, which is Mercury in its own sign, particularly Virgo, right? Mercury and Virgo in 1, 4, 7, or 10, or 5 and 9 as well. You have primarily 1, 4, and 10, because those are the real primary houses of a chart. Those are called Kendra houses. And we'll talk about those types of things in another show, the classification of houses as another distinction in Jyotish or in Indian astrology. But the other ones would be called a Malvaya yoga, which is Venus in its own sign in 1, 4, 7, and 10. You have also what's called a Ruchakra. Ruchaka Mahapurusha Yoga. It's Mars, either exalted or in its own sign in 1, 4, 7, or 10. And then you also have Shasha Yoga, a Shasha Mahapurusha Yoga, which is Saturn in its own sign or exalted in 1, 4, 7, or 10. So those are your five main Mahapurusha Yogas. And LeBron James has a Hamsa Yoga, which is Jupiter in its own sign in the seventh house. So when he marries very well. His wife is quite attractive. He did well. She's very intelligent. She's supportive, right? She's really, you know, become a backbone and a major player in his life with regards to him doing so well. So that's just to show how those yogas work, if you will. They work throughout the dashas. They're released. Their karmic import is released through the life chapter periods.
Indeed, indeed. So real quick about the yogas. So you kind of mentioned yoga as kind of like, for the lack of a better term, like, I guess more of a, you know, benefic, positive light. Is it possible to have yogas that, you know, have a, you know, more negative outlook, you know, combinations that are not, you know, so, you know, beneficial?
You know, brother, they absolutely do. One of the yogas that is very much looked for in India is called a Chandramangal yoga, right? And the word for moon in India is Chandra. Right. When you have a Chandra Mangal yoga, a Mangala is Mars. Right. So we're talking about the way that the moon and Mars are placed. Now, here's the thing, Atef. Nothing in astrology or nothing in life is all bad, right? There's always duality to everything. So one thing that's a negative is a positive somewhere else, and one thing that's a positive is a negative somewhere else. So with a Chandra Mangala, and there's plenty, there's many types of yogas that will produce beneficial effects and also detrimental effects, or let's say challenging effects, right? Because, you know, the Supreme Being is not going to set you up with detriment. It's going to set you up with challenges so that you can learn from those challenges. That's the, right. We don't look at it in that perspective. But a challenging yoga for marriage, and I say for marriage, because Chandra Mangala yoga for business is awesome. It's very, very powerful, right? And when you have that Chandra Mangala yoga, you can do. You're a go-getter. You're a deal maker, right? You can deal in the world of business very, very well. You have a very strong warrior type energy to you, right? Because the moon is being imbued with those martial type energies. But and that, you know, those yogas depend on, you know, the relationship between the moon and Mars. So if the moon is in opposition to the Mars, meaning that if the moon is in any opposite house from Mars, right, it's a Chandra Mangala yoga, right? If the moon is conjunct Mars, right, meaning it's with or sitting with Mars, it's also a Chandra Mangala yoga. And they have other ways that they kind of gauge the yoga. It depends on where it is from Venus, right? In fact, the way they do it, at almost like 80% of the world would have a Chandra Mangala yoga if they use all the combinations. But I stick strictly to the moon, right? Because that one really works very, very well. But when you have that placement, it destroys the marriage. Unless, and it's usually advised you don't want to marry until you're a little older. Right. Until you've kind of understood those fiery energies, those passionate energies that you bring to any type of relationship, whether it be business or personal. But what happens is that they try to pair you with another person with Chandra Mangala yoga, because two negatives equal what? Positive. Right. Yeah. So they cancel each other out, right? They kind of nullify one another. And it's kind of like two bad boys in the same room, right? You know, like, hey, man, I know you bad, I'm bad, so we ain't going to even go there, right? We good, right? Kind of that energy, right? So you would want to see if your moon is in opposition, or if it's even squared, or if it's conjunct Mars. Right. And I say squared, that's a Western term. They don't use that in the East. Right. But if it's in 1, 4, 7, or 10 from the moon, that's considered a Chandra Mangala yoga. So there are some yogas that have some negative imports, definitely. But again, those are challenges that we can definitely meet, provided we have meditation, counseling, oracles, and other things that we're going to talk about that can be used as well to offset those challenging placements.
Yeah, good deal. That's great that you brought it up, because, you know, a lot of people, when it comes to astrology, you know, some people just stay away from it because, you know, they catch the vibe that is, you know, overly fatalistic. It's like, you know, okay, I got this, you know, malefic thing going on in my chart, and there's nothing I can do about it. So why I'd rather not know, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the ostrich puts his head in the sand type syndrome, right? Well, that ain't gonna change what's coming to you, right? It's gonna come to you either way. So if you know it's coming, right, you can brace for the brunt of it. But you know, meditation, you know, consulting a high oracle. Right. A high oracles, you know, now I'm talking about, and I'm not here to knock anyone's use of a oracle that is not considered high. I'm talking about a binary oracle. Right. I Ching, Ifa, or some people say Dilogun, the Medu Netter oracle of Tehuti. Those are very high powered oracles, and it's just like having a conversation with the Supreme Being, that you can get on the line and make a phone call, right? And the Supreme will download to you, say, hey, you know, this is what you need to do or not do, right? Or this is what you're ready to do, right? This is what you can handle, so to speak. Or you can prepare in this way. There's different ways to, you know, tap into those sources. But the other thing is that in this system, there's a difference in that we have remedies. And remedies, you know, is something that has been used in the East for quite some time. I've never really heard. I mean, there are some things that the West has that they use to kind of, you know, navigate, you know, some rough areas in a chart. It's more psychological based, King. It really is. It's more there's more of a mental or psychological approach to like such as counseling, right? To kind of deal with, you know, those types of challenges. And they do have some, they have gemstones that they use as well, right? Like if they say, if your son is born in, if you're born in August, right? Peridot, right? Everyone has their gemstone, if you will, right? But in the East, it's much more refined and much more, it's much deeper as far as those remedies are concerned. And there's even a book, a whole book in India called Lal Kitab, L-A-L-K-I-T-A-B. And that is a whole book on nothing but remedies. And when we say remedies, let me kind of go a little deeper so it makes sense to you, into the world at large is listening. So when we say remedies, we're talking about the use of what we call mantras, right? So people that chant Om, you know, people that use Om quite, you know, they're familiar with that or use it. It has a output in your life. It changes, you know, things are in you, and then henceforth changing things in you changes things around you. Well, mantras are a remedy that we use, right, to literally change the internal atmosphere of a person to reflect the external changes. So the changes happen internally first. It's not external. But that's just one remedy, right? And there's thousands of mantras, right, that can be used. The mantras are even crafted based on your chart specifically for you. Right. So you're using one mantra. If you use the mantra that I use and I use the mantra you use, we may not have the same effect. In fact, it may be detrimental to me if I use the mantra that's been prescribed for you because my planetary placements aren't the same. Another one that we use is called yantra. Right. And yantra is the way a specific this geometry, the way geometry affects consciousness. Right. So we sit in front of that yantra and those shapes literally will begin to shape and shift the spirit internally to begin to function in a more operable way. Right. There is also what we call, they have what's called Rudraksha beads. Rudraksha beads are beads that are harvested from it's like a nut, right? Or a seed, if it's really a seed of a plant, right? And so they have these seeds that they kind of create, and they have the seeds have different numbers of faces. So some of them have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up to, I think, to 11, 12 different faces, right? So, right, those are, it's another, it's almost like gemstones in a will, if you will. You have what's called Vashtu, right? And Vashtu is the Indian parallel to the Chinese feng shui. Right. That is one that is primarily used as well, in that the shape and the placement of the way your house is can change and affect your consciousness. Right. It can change literally how your mind imputes and produces, right, certain effects with regards to direction, right, with regards to shape, with regards to color, with regards to sound. Right. All of those different things in that particular home, right? Or even business, they have a Vashtu for business, right? You know, those all have different ways that it can affect us. So we try to place things in a certain way, just like feng shui has certain zones that you don't want to place certain things in. You don't want to place your children in certain zones, right? So that's another science that we can use, which we call remedies, to try to kind of offset planetary placements that may not be so acquiescent to health or to a marriage or to wealth and so forth. There's another one called yagyas. Yagyas is another. Yagya is like a sacrifice, right? It's a ceremony that a priest will perform that will literally, on your behalf, give you like a receipt with the energy or the planetary energy that you're dealing with to kind of say, hey, this person is making a sacrifice, right? You have charity, right? Charity is another form of remedy. We have fasting, right? Fasting on certain days, certain times, right? All of these are different things that we can use to try to offset any type of challenging placements that we may have in a chart. And so the West is very different in that it really doesn't approach the science from this way. And it's very, very challenging to do so because no one in the West has created or understands the science and the power of mantra. Right. We say Hekau in ancient Kemet or in ancient Egypt or Kemet. Hekau is another word for mantra. Right. So by and large, you know, there's many, many of it. You have all kinds of different things that you can do. And, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be out of a book. It could be something in your spirit that motivates you to give to someone that you see that's in need, right? And it might be at the certain time in a certain place, and you give it to them, and it reflects that certain planetary energy where now that energy is more in your favor, right? It's going to flow better for you depending upon, you know, what's done and how it's done. So, you know, and there's way more remedies than that. I mean, there's all kinds of things that can be done to, again, really reduce any type of malefic energies. And malefic doesn't mean bad necessarily, because malefic can be good and benefic can be bad as well. It doesn't, you know, necessarily work just because it says benefic or malefic. But anything that is not necessarily what we would consider placed well can be offset by these methods. And there's way more difference than that. Then in as far as these systems are concerned, you have Shadbala, you have Vimshopak, you have Ashtakavarga, you have chakras, different types of chakras, Kala chakra. So there's many, 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 many differences or distinctions that come out when you use an Eastern system and it's full, because this stuff has been practiced far longer than in the West, right? I'm talking about, you know, you imagine ancient Egypt has built temples around this stuff. I mean, you know, whole temple complexes, the Giza is aligned to Orion, right? We're talking 3,500 to 2,500 BC, that 1,000 years, right? The ancient Kemetians or Egyptians took, right, the knowledge of the heavens and made it on earth, right? So we're talking far before any Greeks got any of this stuff. We're talking 1,400 BC with the Jyotish Vedanga or Vedanga Jyotish, where that's a book that even shows that in 1400, before Common Era, they were practicing these things. So, you know, this is something that's much older than the West. And so it's been used with spiritual sciences and inculcated with Ayurveda, which is a health system out of India that uses, you know, different modalities of healing as far as health is concerned. You know, they have different ways to offset physical imbalances. So it is a complete science unto itself because it has these other outlets that can assist with regards to those placements.
Wow. Indeed. Well, I think this has been, an excellent breakdown, you know, of kind of getting into the distinctions and, you know, just showing some of the things that you can see in a chart and how powerful it is. You know, one thing I did want to ask you, brother, real quick, since we were dealing with those distinctions, you know, and sun and moon, just real quick. You know, when we were, you know, going back to LeBron's chart, you know, we was talking about how the moon is kind of like, you know, how you think kind of, you know, has a lot of, you know, kind of personality indications. And, you know, for all my sports people who, you know, are tuning in, especially right now, there's a lot of stuff going on with LeBron and the, you know, the Lakers and everything like that. You know, one thing that a lot of people have criticized him for is they say that he doesn't have the killer instinct, right? Now, we go to tropical or Western astrology, we look at his chart. His moon is in Aries, right? Now, brother Rob, what would you say like a moon in Aries type of, you know, mindset would be as compared to what his moon in Sidereal would be Pisces. Just real quick.
Yeah. The moon in Aries is considered, and it's really not, because it's a longstanding argument as to what quote unquote is the first sign. And we'll talk about that in another show as to why Aries would be considered the primary sign, if you will, or the first or number one. But Aries is considered all about me, right? It's a me, I, no team type of sign. It's all about making or taking actions without regard to consequence or without regards to a lateral approach to dealing with others, meaning that your approach or your instincts are going to drive you to manifest things based on your purview and no other purview. And, you know, it can be an athletic mentality if other placements are there, if Mars is helpful in certain houses and certain signs. But the moon being in Pisces is an all-inclusive sign, right? It includes others. The Piscean energy is really about creating win-win scenarios, if you will. It's really about how do we maximize many things to get something done, right? And if he's more of a team player is what I really hear is being said, is the guy is a team player. He uses his team to win, right? Versus using his own apparatus to win solely, right? And the moon in Pisces is very giving, very, very much flexible with regards to seeing the outcome of things. It's a mutable sign, right? So being mutable, it can shift from, right, being cardinal, it can shift back being fixed, right? So in a game, it would make sense that the person would use that mentality to use all options available to get the job done. Right. So definitely you see that moon in Pisces, you know, definitely. I mean, he has the ascendant lord in sixth house. So that gives him his competitive drive, if you will. Right. The sixth house is all about competition. Sixth house is about dealing with enemies, dealing with adversity, overcoming oppositions, overcoming hurdles. Right. Dealing with things that are hard in the sense of that. It's not something that you want to walk into a sixth house energy on a daily basis and say, yeah, I'm good here. No, it deals with illnesses. It deals with disease. It deals with conflict. So when your ascendant lord, and we talked about the ascendant, when the lord of your ascendant, meaning the ruler of you, is in the sixth house, it has that ability to fight, right? Has that ability to make something happen, yeah. Right? So definitely he has that competitive energy in him, but the moon is a filter for that energy, like we talked.
Yeah. Right?
And it's going to filter it to say, you know what, even though I know I can do this, how can we do this?
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, we can, and we could table it right there, man. This has been a, excellent conversation indeed. Before we get out of here, you got anything that you want to tell the people?
I made a video briefly or made a video on the whole Iran piece with America and Iran. And it's not only just about America and Iran. It's about the fact that there's going to be a solar eclipse on the 2nd of July. And during this period of time, we definitely want to just, keep our energies light. Not to say that something will happen on the 2nd of July. That's not necessarily it. And usually those triggers don't come until a little later with regards to personal apparatuses, or even large scale apparatus as far as countries and things of that nature. But we definitely want to set the tone, if you will, for that day. Right. Be positive, be helpful, be uplifting, be buoyant, right? We say light as a feather, right? Don't let things, that might be, adversarial challenge you to the point where you react, right? Because eclipses, as I mentioned in that video, can clip your will, right? They can short circuit your ability to think and reason properly, right? So definitely on those days, especially right around before July 1st, July 3rd, keep a buoyant spirit. Say positive things to other people. Say positive things to yourself, because what you'll find is that when you plant those seeds that day, and because the soil is so fertile as far as the spirit is concerned, 6 months later, you'll reap the benefits. You'll reap something that will at least come back and say, hey, you know what? We did that right. We did at least offset this day by some positivity, and now we can at least deal with any type of negative impacts that might have. So that's my really own announcement for this. At this point, we'll definitely have more announcements coming up next week.
Indeed, indeed, indeed. And just, you know, real quick again, make sure you go check out, Push It Forward Media Group on pushitforward.com, PUSHITFWD.com. Follow us at Push It Forward. Spelled just like the website. Follow our new project, Veg Kingdom, at Veg Kingdom TV on Instagram. It's on the YouTube channel as well. Just, search Push It Forward Media Group on YouTube, and you can see all the content that we're producing. And, make sure you go and, check out Brother Ra, in Kala Purusha Astrology. He has consultations. He's teaching classes, all sorts of things. So if you want to take some of the stuff that you're learning here and take it to the next level, make sure you definitely get with Brother Ra over here to do that, because we're just scratching the surface. Indeed.
Indeed. Well, appreciate that, King. And y'all stay up, and till next time.
Peace.
Peace.